a certain age, your resume is long. It's just the way it is. Thank you for inviting me to be here this evening. It's a pleasure to be here. And thank you, Yaka, for putting all of this together. I've heard several of the speakers, and I'm going to try not to repeat things that others have said. Everybody has given really terrific information. I think you have a sense of the scope of the problem, or the essence of the problem in New York City and Brooklyn. But I'd like to start by just giving you some numbers that I'm not sure you've had yet. Forgive me if I'm repeating this. Last year in the city, we experienced 1,441 fatal opioid overdoses. 1,441. In Brooklyn, 350 last year. This year, suspected fatal overdoses, and I say suspected because they haven't yet all been confirmed, but they're suspected that that's the reason for the cause of death. In 2018, just so far, 411, and in Brooklyn, 87. So far, this year. What do we do in the police department when we hear numbers like this, and we know that these numbers total more than homicides and car crashes? We equip every single police officer on patrol with Narcan, because the basic, most fundamental core value of the police department is to protect life. That's why police officers carry tourniquets. That's why they're trained in CPR. That's why they know how to deliver babies. And that's why they carry Narcan. And that's new, but this is where we are. This epidemic, this crisis, really accelerated over the last few years, as you've heard, because of fentanyl, very much so. It's a different situation because of fentanyl. The risk of death is that much greater. So, as we carry naloxone or Narcan, in 2017, the police department on its own, there are many other agencies, there's EMS, there are community-based organizations, but the police department administered Narcan 280 times and 56 times in Brooklyn. Yeah, it's pretty great. So, there's one more thing, just another context note that I'd like to say. And I said hello to my partners here in the front. It's good to see you all. We know that many people face co-occurrence of mental health problems and substance use problems, that they go together frequently. We know that we've had, is our OSS speaker still here? Yes? My sense of your statistics are that almost half of the non-crisis discharges, so somebody who left an OSS-funded facility, not for a crisis, almost half of them involved patients with co-occurring substance use and mental health disorders. That's a significant statement. So what are we about, all of us? The push is to get people to treatment. And when law enforcement is involved, it's leverage. And that's what it is, and it's a motivator. But I'm going to say this now, and I'm going to say this at the end. We shouldn't need law enforcement leverage or motivation to get people into treatment. Often, that's what works. Often, that is the bottom for people. Often, that is the turning point. But we have enough treatment options in New York City. I'm not talking about other counties in New York. I'm not talking about other states. I'm not talking about other jurisdictions around the country that can't say this. In New York City, we have enough treatment and enough treatment options that everyone who wants treatment should be able to access treatment. We can say that. So our challenge as a community is to figure out all the different ways to overcome all the barriers that exist to get people into treatment. You've heard about stigma. You've heard about people not knowing where they can turn. You've heard about maybe it's closed, it's not 24 hours. Lots of barriers. But that's our challenge, all of us. And that's what I give this audience here in the room and those of you watching. Our challenge is to figure out how to motivate people beyond criminal justice leverage. So you've heard about CLEAR. We are very proud partners in the CLEAR initiative. I was waiting to hear that it expanded yesterday. I'm glad that that happened, and we will expand it again to all of Brooklyn in the next fiscal year. So I'm going to need to tell you about CLEAR. I want to tell you about some initiatives that you may not know about. Another initiative, another partnership, this time with the Health Department. There are two community health diversion centers that will be opening in New York City during 2018. And my hope is that we have many more to follow. This is a very interesting model that already has been tried in other jurisdictions where police officers are able to see someone who may have committed a low-level violation, may be known to be or believed to be someone who has either a mental health or substance use problem, and the police officer can offer to the person pre-arrest services that are completely voluntary. Is there leverage? Is there a little bit of an or else? If you don't accept these, we may arrest you right now. We could do that, but it's voluntary. There is no court looking at you. There's no date. There's nothing hanging over your head if you accept these services. These are community health diversion centers where the only, they're kind of a misnomer because they're not really community health clinics. The only way you get to go to these centers is if a police officer brings you there. So what that means is it's a dedicated pre-arrest diversion option for officers. It's another tool in our toolbox. CLEAR and HOPE that you heard about, which is in Staten Island and soon to be in the Bronx, those are post-arrest pre-arraignment options. What that means is you're already a little bit in, and as you heard, you don't have to go to court if you engage in different time periods. This is, if you engage now, if you go to this center, it's completely pre-arrest. There's nothing. There's no record of this encounter. You would go to a center that has a certain small amount of beds, small amount of chairs for people to be in, be there overnight if they need to be, get mental health or substance use treatment, short-term case management to connect you to ongoing health care and treatment in the community. This is a terrific model. It's the answer to the question that officers ask all the time. This person has a problem. What am I supposed to do with this person? Where am I supposed to take this person? They're not quite bad enough that I should be taking them to a psychiatric ward because they're, in the moment, dangerous to themselves or others. And yet, they're bad enough that if there is no intervention, either their social problems, their health problems, or their criminal justice problems are going to get worse. So what do I do with this person? And I think these centers will fill that void for a lot of people, and I'm very, very excited about this. So you have to be 18 years old. That's one limitation. Because you're making that decision to accept this. We think you can be there for up to 3 days. There'll be nursing staff there, clinical staff there. There will be peers there as well to talk to people and work with them. And there'll be security there. We hope that officers are there literally no more than 5 to 10 minutes. Here you are. Here, comfortable, everybody happy? Anybody need to know anything? Good luck. And I hope you get what you need right here. So that's a great option. The second initiative that I want to tell you about, I hope you already know about. I hope you saw great posters that we had running in New York City for 4 months that told all New Yorkers about the Good Samaritan Law, the New York State Good Samaritan Law, which says that if you're seeking help for yourself or for someone else, during an overdose that you will not be arrested. The caller or the person you're calling about during an overdose, you will not be arrested. So that's a message that the New York City Police Department wanted all New Yorkers to know. Do not ever hesitate to call 911. We will come. We will help you. EMS will come. Nobody's getting arrested. Never, never hesitate to call 911. So I hope you saw that campaign. It was up in buses, subways, Staten Island Ferry. We pushed it out on cell phones. We even had a mobile billboard truck driving around the city. How many of you saw it? That's it? Okay. Sorry. You should have seen it, but now you have heard the message. Please spread that word. No one should ever hesitate to call 911. There's one more initiative that I want to tell you about because I want you to really appreciate, I hope, that your government is working on your behalf. We believe that if everybody knew what the answer was to the opioid crisis, we wouldn't have an opioid crisis, right? If everybody knew exactly what to do, we'd be doing it. So we decided as city agencies to come together voluntarily four times a year to review cases of fatal overdoses. And it's government agencies sitting around one table in police headquarters looking at what happened in each of these cases. Is there any way that anything could have been done? If the protocol was different, if the policy was different, if you had different resources at your disposal, what might have been done differently to save this person's life? Could anything have been done? We meet together, and it's about 30 to 35 agencies, city and state agencies, who sit around a table. We meet together, we talk about these cases, we raise issues, and quite frankly, and this is the part I like, but it sounds strange when I say it, we don't try and solve any problems at these meetings. All we do at these meetings is identify issues. What about if these people had Narcan? What about if these people had been open 24 hours a day? What about if these people had a different kind of screening test? So we identify issues, and out of these three-hour meetings, there are about 30 to 40 issues that get identified each time. In between these meetings, we try and address those issues. That's what that time is for. And then that's a pretty tight deadline in city government. You have 3 months to try and resolve this. And at the beginning of each meeting, we talk about the progress that was made from the meeting before. And I tell you this just to say, I want you to know that we are all struggling with this. We've made lots of improvements as a result of those meetings. Lots of things have changed. There are more resources. There are different policies. There are different protocols. The state is at the table. OSS is at the table. Regional government agencies are at the table. It's law enforcement, health, probation, parole, homeless services. Everybody's around the table together. So, you know, I promised you that I'd be short. I want you to understand that we are doing interesting and creative things. I think it's meetings like this where we can learn from you and hear what your questions are. The two things I want you to know, there are two numbers that you've got to keep in your head. One is never hesitate to call 911 in the event of an overdose. Nobody's getting arrested. And the other is 188-NYC-WELL. You call about yourself or you can call about someone else. And you can describe what the situation is. You should be able to get connected to mental health or substance use services from NYCWELL. And if you have any issue with that, if you call and you can't get through, you can call me. But I mean that 100%. NYCWELL is, have you ever heard of LifeNet? Do you remember LifeNet? So LifeNet doesn't exist anymore. LifeNet was pretty much a suicide prevention hotline. NYCWELL is LifeNet on steroids. It's about many different topics. It's 24 hours a day, and you should be able to access a wide range of services. Don't hesitate to call. Thank you.